Hello, everyone, and welcome into the first picture show of the new school year. I'm your host, James Martin Farrar III, and today I'm being joined by Melanie Flores. So, Melanie, first and foremost, how was your summer break, and more importantly, did you see any good movies over the summer?
Yes, it was great. How was yours?
It was really good. What was your favorite one from everything?
I saw Once Upon a Time in Hollywood, Endgame. Those are things that are just coming to mind. I think those are probably my favorite ones.
All right. Well, I ask because today we're talking about summer recap, and of course the biggest movies of the summer were the Marvel movies. They wrapped up Phase 3 this summer, and they had two movies come out. I guess the first one came out right there as the summer started with Avengers Endgame, and then Spider-Man Far From Home a few months after that. But we definitely have to talk about those because it was the biggest thing in the summer. It was the biggest thing probably of the last two decades, almost movie-wise. I think it broke all sorts of records. And Before we get to those, though, let's go ahead and start out with some trailers. So let's show you the trailers for Avengers Endgame and Spider-Man Far From Home.
Hey, Ms. Potts.
If you find this recording,
don't feel bad about this.
Part of the journey is the end. Just for the record, being adrift in space with zero promise of rescue is more fun than it sounds. Food and water ran out 4 days ago. Oxygen will run out tomorrow morning. That'd be it. When I drift off, I will dream about you. It's always you.
Thanos did exactly what he said he was going to do. He wiped out 50% of all living creatures.
We lost, all of us. We lost friends. We lost family. We lost a part of ourselves. This is the fight of our lives.
This is gonna work, Steve.
I know it is. Because I don't know what I'm going to do if it doesn't.
Hi, is anyone home? This is Scott Lang. We met a few years ago at the airport in Germany. That got really big.
Is this an old message?
Ant-Man, I know you know that.
It's the front door.
That's me. Can you buzz me in?
Thank you, Spider-Man.
That was so good.
Hey, sorry I'm late.
Happy.
You look nice.
Thank you. You too.
Thank you. New dress?
Yes, it is. How'd you know?
What just happened?
Planning a trip?
Mm-hmm. Going to Europe. School trip.
Did you get your passport? Peter Parker here to pick up your passport, please. Mini toothpaste?
Mm-hmm.
Pack your suit.
I just want to go on my trip with my friends.
Europe doesn't really need a friendly neighborhood Spider-Man.
You look really pretty.
And therefore, I have value.
No, that's not.
I'm right. Messing with you. You look pretty too.
I just want to spend some time with MJ. I think she really likes you, dude.
That must be my first time alone. I had just finished my food call.
So nice to finally meet you, Spider-Man.
You're Nick Fury.
Put some clothes on. Let's go for a ride.
Is he gonna be okay like that?
Might want to turn him over so he doesn't swallow his tongue.
I think Nick Fury just hijacked our summer vacation.
Awesome!
We got gifts, Parker, but we have a job to do. Are you going to step up or not?
You're all alone. Your friends are in trouble. What are you going to do about it?
You don't want any part of this.
He's like Iron Man and Thor rolled into one.
He's no Spider-Man.
What is it with you and Spider-Man?
But he looks out for the neighborhood, has a dope suit, and I really respect him. Sup, dickwad?
So, I will go ahead and say spoiler alert before we get into it, just in case anybody hasn't seen either one of the movies, but honestly, at this point, if they haven't, then it's kind of their own fault if we ruin it for them, right? Before we get into it, and we're going to start out with Avengers Endgame, just to kind of take them in order, but why don't you let everybody know where we left off at the end of Infinity War, because we kind of come right into Endgame from there. So where do we kind of leave off on that one?
So Thanos is there, and I believe Gamora has been killed, Loki has been killed, the Scarlet Vision has been killed.
Right, yeah.
A lot of them, about like 13 or 20 of them have been killed by him.
Right, the finger snap, right?
Yeah. And then Nebula and Tony Stark left on their ship, and they're stuck in outer space.
Okay, so right off the bat, we knew they were going to have to save Tony somehow. They do that with Captain Marvel, and that takes place very early, but I want to talk about the first 15 minutes because I didn't really know what to expect going in. I kind of had an idea, but 15 minutes in, people don't even have time to get their popcorn eaten yet, and they've already found Thanos, and Thor's chopped his head off. Like, that threw me for a loop. I did not see it coming, and I had no idea where they were going from there. What did you think about the beginning and just kind of how they did that right off the bat?
I felt the same way. I mean, it was really interesting. I mean, everyone's reaction was, they were just totally shocked, and I was really interested in how they were going to go. I didn't think that was going to happen, and it was really interesting to see Thor in the state that he was in. I was shocked as well.
What about the time jump? Because they immediately go from that and then 5 years later.
Yeah, it was kind of confusing for me at first, and just really wondering where they were going to go with the story, and how they were going to defeat him and move on from that with just the few of them that came back from the time that they were gone.
For me, once they killed him, it wasn't really for, I didn't, how much they're going to, how are they going to defeat him? Mm-hmm. I didn't know who they had to defeat. You know?
Yeah.
They were still trying to bring the people back, but the stones were gone, the bad guy was dead. I mean, they were still in a bad place, but they really had nobody to fight at that point, which kind of it was a very nice surprise, because it could have been they could have done the story in a way that everybody kind of saw coming, and they didn't do that, and they immediately let you know it's not going to be what you think it is.
Mm-hmm.
But the majority of the movie was, you know, trying to undo the snap and bring everybody back. They ended up doing that with Ant-Man and the Quantum Realm with, I think they called it the Time Heist. What did you think about how they did that? There were only a few ways they could do it, really. Mm-hmm. I thought time travel would be a thing. So what did you think about that one?
It made me really happy, because of the fact that there were just a few of them that were there, and they were trying to, like you said, bring everyone back. And it was nice to have him there. Added on, and I was just really happy to see him and just have him pop up, because I love Ant-Man.
I thought it was cool they had him stuck there for 5 years.
Yes.
Like, and it was only 5 hours for him, but 5 years stuck somewhere would have that would have been horrible. Although I don't know the people that were in the snap thing, it seemed like they didn't realize it had been 5 years when they came back either. So,
mm-hmm.
They brought back the some other characters that were dead. Thanos, of course, they brought back the older version of him. They had the two Nebulas, and they brought back Gamora, which I was so glad they didn't bring back the version that died. You know, they made it. But how did you feel about the way they did that? They managed to bring all those characters back. Even Loki's back now. Mm-hmm. But without kind of completely ruining the story that they had already told with them dying.
Yeah, they really did that in a really smart way because it helped the plot and what they were trying to go for. Because, you know, Thanos coming back and he had his extra helper to kind of get back at them and kind of ruin their plan of trying to defeat him again.
Right. At one point, they had all the Chitauri from the first Avengers movie mm-hmm. that were all gone. Were back at the end of it to fight because of the way they did that. This movie also saw the end for a lot of the original characters. Steve Rogers, Natasha Romanoff, they sort of wrapped their stories up. We'll talk about Tony Stark in a minute. That's the big one, obviously. But how did you feel about the way they wrapped up those stories with some of the main characters that we kind of knew were going away, mm-hmm. but we weren't really sure if they were going to kill them off or if they were going to, you know, how they did that? What did you think about those?
I think they did it in a really honorable way and a very cinematic way. And like we've watched these characters develop and grow over the years. We feel so attached to them. But I felt like it was necessary just to make the story stand out and kind of go along with what they were trying to do with it.
And right now we're going to go ahead and take a really quick break. But when we come back, we're going to be talking a little bit more about Avengers Endgame. We still have Spider-Man Far From Home later. And Abby Colvin is going to have what's new on DVD and streaming.
It's time to join forces. Get energized. And fuel up right. Because starting today, every kid in America has a mission. Bring out the action hero in you. Part of the greatest action movie ever. The first movie that puts you in the action. Show us how you train and eat like an action hero. Join in at actionheroalliance.com.
GED diploma, the barriers in your life fall. Take the first step and get free GED information in your area at 1-877-38-YOUR-GED or yourged.org. Earn your GED diploma and begin your brighter future.
Good afternoon. Welcome to our first streaming and DVD picks of the semester. I'm Abby Colvin, and let's get to it. First up on Hulu for the month of August, we have Zookeeper, starring Kevin James and Rosario Dawson. A beloved zookeeper is planning to leave his job in search of love when his animal friends reveal they can speak and devise a plan that will keep him at the zoo and get him the girl of his dreams. Next on Netflix, Glow Season 3, starring Allison Brie and Marc Maron. A group of women working for a televised wrestling organization in the 1980s must handle the struggles of professionalism in the midst of their own personal lives and must find ways to balance the two. And finally, for streaming on Amazon, Poltergeist 2, starring JoBeth Williams and Craig T. Nelson. 1 year after leaving their home to escape evil supernatural forces, a family must find ways to cope with the reality that their haunting isn't over and the demon is back with vengeance. Now moving on to DVD picks, we have Detective Pikachu, starring Ryan Reynolds and Justice Smith. A boy discovers his father, a detective, has gone missing and finds help with a Pokemon only he can understand. Together, they must team up with other Pokemon to work to solve the mystery of the missing detective. Avengers Endgame, starring Robert Downey Jr. and Chris Evans. In the final installment of the Marvel Avengers series, the Avengers must assemble one last time to defeat Thanos and save the universe. Sacrifices must be made and the war must be won, no matter the consequences. Rocket Man, starring Taron Egerton and Jamie Bell. A look into the life of Elton John and all the breakthroughs and struggles he endured in his early stages of his career, as well as his impact on the music industry. That's all for this month's streaming and DVD. I'm Abby Kalba. Now back to the Picture Show.
Welcome back. This is the Picture Show, and today we're talking about the end of Marvel's Phase 3. They wrapped up over the summer with their two movies, and before the break we were discussing how Marvel and Disney brought a little bit of closure to the storylines of Steve Rogers and Black Widow, especially some of those original characters. But now I want to talk about the big one, because the biggest moment in the movie, and it was another one I didn't see coming. I thought, if anything, he might survive, just because Robert Downey Jr. was such an integral part of the MCU. I guess it made sense that he did it, but I also thought that might be the reason he survived. But big battle goes on, and he just kind of bumps into Thanos in 2 seconds, takes him, puts him on the glove, and does his own little finger snap of doom. What did you think about Iron Man being the one to do it, the way they did it, and kind of how they brought his story to a close? Because I don't think a lot of people saw that coming, but once they did it, it really made a lot of sense to me.
Mm-hmm. I agree. It was a really epic moment in the movie. And everyone was like, you know, he's Tony Stark, he's Iron Man, he can't die. And it kind of just added something really interesting to the story, and how all these characters that we just love, and where they're dying, but and we've lost them in a way, but not because their legacy lives on. They did it in a way that just kind of made sense. What was really emotional was when the characters came by his side, and Spider-Man came to him, and Pepper came to him.
Right, they had almost that father-son relationship, yeah, those two. So
you kind of had like a sense of closure, because they gave them that moment to say their goodbye. So it was like the audience was saying goodbye to him.
Right, and I really hope that they don't, a year from now, find out some way to bring him back and kind of undo that, because it really was such, it was like a TV show that has a perfect ending and then has another season a year later. It just wouldn't make any sense. I think they ended it perfectly, and they need to leave that alone, you know. But we're going to kind of wrap up the Endgame part of the discussion. They did have another movie that came out after that, although for me, I thought Endgame would have been the perfect place to end Phase 3. I don't really think Spider-Man was necessary for mm-hmm. that. How did you feel about that? Did you think they needed the other movie, or should they have ended it there?
I think they should have ended it. I think they continued it for some fans, maybe what some of them wanted. And just having Spider-Man kind of, it's like his legacy kind of transferred on from Endgame right into Spider-Man. And it's like they were wanting him to be alive in some way.
I feel like that would have been a perfect start to something else,
yeah,
and they used it as an end to it. And
yeah,
it didn't make a lot of sense to me the way they did it. But any final thoughts on Endgame? Anything we missed that you wanted to talk about before we jump into Spider-Man?
I thought it was just a really great movie, and I think they just did it in a really smart way to kind of end that that kind of era of superhero movies. Yeah.
Okay, so after Endgame, about 2 months later, we did have one more movie in the Infinity Saga, as they're calling it. It was the 23rd Marvel movie overall, and that was Spider-Man Far From Home. What were the initial impressions you had coming out of Endgame, where Spider-Man was at the beginning of the movie? He seems kind of haunted almost. How did you feel about the way they carried his character over? I feel like they were going to make him the centerpiece mm-hmm. at that point. Did you like the way they started that, or should they have done something different?
It was just, I don't know. It was like I wasn't really expecting them to do that, and whenever it happened, I was like, oh, okay, this is what they're trying to do, and they're trying to kind of pass the torch on, and you know, to Spider-Man. And I kind of agree with you. I felt like it was a little unnecessary, but I understand why they did it.
You could really feel it too. Like the weight of Iron Man really kind of hung over that movie a lot, and I'm assuming that was intentional, obviously, that they wanted to make it feel that heavy, but it was a lot of presence there. When we pick up Peter Parker at the beginning of Far From Home, he's reunited with Ned, everybody's back from the snap. I do kind of like the way they played that in a little bit with the people that were 5 years younger when they left that are now the same age, and people are, you know, the 21-year-old that's 16 and that sort of thing. I like how they did that. It was a little bit lighter coming off of something so heavy. And they were really pushing Spider-Man here to be that next big guy, and I love how they brought Nick Fury back for this one. I felt like that was almost necessary. Yes. Because at the beginning he kind of tied everything together, and then Iron Man sort of tied everything together, and now with him gone, Nick Fury's back to tie everything together. What did you think about them bringing him back? He hasn't been around for a long time now.
Yeah, I thought it was really nice to do that for that character since he was gone for such a long time, and he kind of like. Tony was kind of like Spider-Man's father figure, and they kind of made Nick his new father figure in a way, to kind of guide him, because he's so young, and he even said in the story he was questioning, like, all of these people are asking me, am I the next big thing? And he's like, I'm just a kid. And he was there to kind of guide him and be his mentor.
Right. I love the relationship that he's had with those characters, all Iron Man and Nick Fury and just everybody. Yeah. Because he really has, in just a couple movies, gone from I want to be the neighborhood guy to I want to be the next Avenger to I want to be the neighborhood guy again. And yeah. Now I'm the main guy. And it really has been kind of an up and down for him. And I do like how they've done that. Nick Fury comes in. We see Cobie Smulders back as Agent Hill. And that's when they introduce the bad guy. Now, I'm not big with the comic book versions of these, but I know a lot of people have been excited about hearing about the multiverses, and this is the first time they really kind of bring that in. What did you think of the casting of Jake Gyllenhaal?
I thought it was weird at first when I saw the trailer, and I was like, Jake Gyllenhaal? You know, I was like, I never pictured him in that role. And then once he did it, I thought he did a really great job.
That was actually my first thought, too, was yeah. Superhero movie, Jake. Okay, but it did. It went well, and I like that they brought him into not even because they had a tendency with every movie to build it up, and the next bad guy was bigger than the last bad guy, and now we've got the last one for this part of it at least, and he's just a regular guy.
Mm-hmm.
So what did you think about that coming off of Thanos, and you know now we've just got a regular. He's a magician almost, you know, stunt guy that's just a nobody really and truly. And that's the bad guy at the very last movie that they, you know?
Yeah, it felt very casual. Like, he just felt kind of on the same level as Spider-Man, which maybe was kind of like a way to kind of step back and take a breath because Thanos is just, like, such a big, you know, bad guy. But then I thought it was really interesting for the plot to, you know, take him, who he was hurt by Tony Stark, and kind of turn that against Spider-Man and kind of this emotional thing that he's going through.
He definitely was manipulative. It was almost like a Lex Luthor type bad guy, to yeah. you know, borrow a page from DC. It was more smarts than anything else. There wasn't really any brawn to it. It was more brain, which those are my favorite type of bad guys.
Yes.
Personally, I like the guy that's going to outthink you, even though you know he's not going to beat you
yeah.
up. So Mysterio spends the first half of the movie fighting the Terrestrials, I think they're called, that are from another multiverse, as he mm-hmm. tells it. And he's a good guy and plays everybody, plays Fury, who's, I don't think anybody's ever seen him get played in any of the movies. He's the guy that knows everything. And then they do the turn. He gets the glasses, and you find out what he really is. What did you think about that scene? You know, he comes in, he gets to us, and then now he's just a Stark employee that had planned all of this out. Did you see that one coming, or did that one kind of take you by surprise too?
That took me by surprise. Like, literally my mouth fell open. I was like, where is this gonna go? And it's in the wrong hands. And you know, it was a really like touchy you know, emotional thing, because it was Tony Stark's glasses, like kind of the only like physical, you know, thing left of him, and it's in the wrong hands, like right after he passed away.
I think we should know by now that if Tony builds something that can talk to you, it's probably going to end up in the wrong hands at
yeah.
some point, because
yeah.
every single thing he's built that talks to people has ended up in the wrong hands at some point. We're going to finish up our conversation on that later. We're kind of at the midpoint for Far From Home, but right now we're going to go to Kayla Kennedy for the Friday Flick Pick and take our last commercial break, and don't go anywhere because we'll be right back.
anything. We make sure they get to college. Federal student aid provides more than $150 billion in grants, loans, and work-study funds to make college possible for anyone with a mind to get there. Because if given the chance, minds will do great things. Federal Student Aid, proud sponsor of the American Mind. Learn more about money for college at studentaid.gov. But it would be safe
to keep your distance. Good afternoon. Thank you for tuning in to this week's Friday Flick Pick. I'm Kayla Kennedy. Ready or Not is a thriller based on everyone's favorite childhood game of hide and seek, starring Samara Weaving and Adam Brody. On the night of a bride's wedding, her new in-laws show just how crazy in-laws can be. They force her to join in their own game of hide and seek, and now she must fight for her life. Let's take a look at the trailer.
I can't believe that in half an hour, I will be a part of the Ladomus Gaming Dynasty Empire.
Dominion, we prefer Dominion.
I honestly can't wait to be a part of your family.
There's just one more thing, and then you are officially part of the family. So, at midnight, you have to play a game.
Why?
It's just something we do when someone new joins the family.
A game. What game? Hide and seek? Are we really gonna play that?
Well, the rules are simple. You can hide anywhere. We then try to find you.
So there's no way for me to win, right?
And stay hidden till dawn.
No, thank you.
Good luck.
What the hell is this? How old is this thing?
I know you're in here.
Sweetheart.
You shot the maid.
Does she look like she's wearing a giant white wedding dress, Emily?
It's insane.
I had to play along so that I can get you out. They think they have to kill you before sunrise. Or something very bad will happen to the family.
If we don't find her and perform the ritual, we're all dead.
Found her.
Damn it, Emily!
I don't know what I'm doing!
Today's video is called Getting to Know Your Crossbow.
Ah, I forgot my gun.
Why don't you just use mine?
Mr. Ladomus, I just saw her running.
Oh my god!
You're just another sacrifice.
Did you think this is a game?
Yes, I didn't see. Remember?
He wanted to get married.
Someone's not going!
No!
Are you serious?
That's all for this week's Friday Flick Pick. I'm Kayla Kennedy. Now let's get you back to the picture show.
We're going to wrap up picture show right now. So, in the movie, Spider-Man wins, Mysterio dies at the end. I would like to thank my co-host Melanie Floyds for being with us today and not yelling at me like the last time I was here. My name is Jennifer Martin Ferrall III. This has been The Picture Show, and we will be back next week, same day, same time, with a new movie, so we hope to see you there.